Hello everyone, Brett Settles here with the second entry of our Clash Automation video series here, and what we're going to be talking about here, after really kind of recapping the important things that one needs to understand to jump into Clash Automation with the first entry, we're going to actually craft a Clash test today. So once the understanding of search sets and appearance profiles and everything are there, you're really ready to jump in. Now, there's also some other understanding of how our stamps work that can take this all the way through issue automation. But we're really going to focus on this session of creating the test and getting all the way to the point where results are generated. So what I'm going to do is up here, right underneath preferences, you're going to see the Clash Automation button. Now, as I select that, we're going to see the Clash Automation dialog show up on the left-hand side of our screen. Now, there's a couple things to realize here, what is going on, and this is a little bit different than what we've had in the past, is that each one of these tests can be generated by anybody that has the correct permissions. These tests can be checked out or checked back in by each user. Here you can see that I am using this Clash test, and Sean is using this Clash test. If I select this test, I can see here that it is being edited by myself. When I go into this, here we can see that that Clash test is being edited. So there are warnings all over about who has each Clash test out. If I jump into a test that somebody else has, I can look at and get to any of the information in here. I can expand that. I can focus in on individual objects related to that clash. I can jump through these clash results and take a look at them. But what I cannot do is change any of the criteria. So I cannot change any of this. I cannot change its status. As you can see here, before it gets moved into an issue, we can see that there are statuses to say if the coordinators have reviewed it or not. I cannot change any of this. However, if I go and I grab a clash test, I can go here and check out that test. This gives me the ability to go in here and actually edit some of these items. So if I need to select two groups or three groups here, and I want to actually create a manual group with this, I can do that. So I can group these three together, and now I have those three grouped as one single clash. Now, not the greatest example visually, but here you can see we can jump right back through all the other clashes here. If I go back out, you can see that it's telling me that I am editing this right now. And I believe I have this checked out on a secondary device, which is why you're seeing that name right there. So we can jump in, we can view what other people are up to, but if they're actively working in it, we do have mechanisms to keep people from working on top of each other and making sure that that's always being taken care of by one person and we're not stepping on the toes of our fellow employees. Now let's go ahead and create a test here. So test creation is very simple, and we're going to walk through what all these buttons mean here, but here is where I can create a new clash test. Now in here, this is where I can go through and actually see, all right, what are my clash tests here? And what do I have over here? Now we're gonna look for a system or a clash test that has not been done yet. And what we're gonna do is we are going to say sanitary over here versus the structure over on this side. As we've got those search sets set up, very easy. And we're going to simply give it a name. As we go in here and create this, we'll go ahead and say done. And it will show us that there is a new clash test that we are creating. Now from this test, I can import any of the criteria from any other test if it fits. So here we've got sanitary versus structural. We're going to solve this a lot like we did mechanical versus structure. So we can import that, and we can bring in the clashing type, what levels we're using, grids, groups and group naming, clash naming, metadata, clash view and screenshot settings, issue automation, and even the editors that are already on the other test. Now, we'll go through on how to set each of these, but this is a way that you can quickly template out your test based on any of these settings that you're going to be reusing. So when I import and continue, as you can see behind me, all of that information quickly filled out, and I can go in and review that here in a second. Clashing type, we have hard, clearances horizontal and vertical with those being different, tolerances, as well as horizontal and vertical tolerances. So lots of various options there. And then we have the ability to choose if we're clashing elements or geometry. We can ignore clashes in the same model or duplicates. So as I say next, it will then ask me, how do I want to group these? If you've noticed, we've moved all of the processes that a human would need to put into the software up to the front of the process so that we can get all this done right out of the gate, but still have all of that information that we want to use and have control over how we use. So here you can see that we're automatically grouping by levels, rooms, system classification, and proximity. If I need to add a grouping, it's very easy. I click on add a grouping, and now I can go in and say, all right, well, I also want to group on grid intersection. And I can even drag and drop that into its place with priority. So here we can see level, room, mechanical system classification, grid with a proximity. And it is going to give us all of that in the name automatically based on our grouping scheme. And it's also going to name each clash based on the elements that it's pulling from. So a very informative, automated way to set up your nomenclature. As we choose next, then we get the ability to do issue automation. Now we will be covering this in detail in a further course here. But this option does pop up at the beginning, but we do have a way to separate those. So we're going to go ahead and say finish. And what you'll see is this test is now set up. It has not been run yet. And over here, we can see that the clash test name is sanitary versus structure, which is editable. We have the selection sets here, which can also be edited at any time. What type of collision? How we want the automated grouping to work, how we want metadata to be displayed, which we'll get into when we look at the actual results and issues. We also have the ability to change the view in the screenshot. And what's really nice about this is that we can do all of our clashes at a single time just by using this box here, where we can change the color of our selections. We can have resolved or approved clashes show up as a completely different color. We can choose the zoom factor, our default section box, as well as how that section box is clipped on a height aspect. Here we have issue screenshot settings, the ability to choose how we want the appearance profiler to work. Do we want two or three colors for clash representing that approved? How do we want the transparency to work? I'm going to make it to where none of these are transparent. Here we can also isolate or isolate in transparency. So now everything will be transparent except for the clashing objects. We can apply a section box and even update the viewpoints for a certain type of issue or clash. So any of the change clashes, all change except for manual where the screenshot may have been updated already. So lots of flexibility in the way that we do these screenshots. Issue automation. We will cover this in its own section, but here's where those settings take place as well. And I will also cover how we select if we're doing just clash results or creating issues or both at the same time. Here we have access rights. These are the administrators in the clash testing environment. This shows what all of these individuals can do and what that test privacy is whenever those are created. Here we have labels, which are additional pieces of metadata we can manually enter to be able to identify our clash tests or further our reporting needs. Down here, the final two settings are what level or what model are we pulling our levels from, and what model are we pulling our grids from. Now, all of this is set up. So, how do we move forward? Well, this is actually very easy as well. As up here, you can see that we have three buttons. We have the ability to run clash detection, the ability to sync those clashes with the issue tracker if we see fit as a coordination team, or if we're feeling really confident, the ability to automate both processes at the same time and automatically go from clash detection and automatic grouping all the way to issues and automatic reporting. So there are some options here, and we wanted to make sure that we had these options to fit every sort of workflow that we've encountered through our feedback period. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do the first part, which is running the clash detection and reviewing some of the results. Once I go ahead and run this, we're going to see that it found 732 new clashes and grouped into 164 groups based on my grouping criteria. When I say okay, we can see that 732 hits, 164 groups, 164 clashing items to be resolved here. If I expand this out, I can actually see quite a bit of metadata, and I don't want to take up too much real estate, but we can see when that was created, when the deadline is defined, who the assignee is, what the stamp default is based on how we want to automate issues. All of this is here. If I want to dive further into the test, I can click open, and now I can actually see the results of this test. I can see what level, what room, and what exact objects are clashing. My zoom factor is set a little close, but here we can actually see where we are not fitting into that sleeve. We can see some similar issues with sleeves and sanitary pipe here as well, all grouped based on that information. Now, let's say that my zoom factor is a little too tight. I can actually go back to the test and change that view in that screenshot right away. So I'm going to go ahead and check this out, this test. As you can see here, I'm editing that test now. Oh, my apologies. I'm going to go to view and screenshot, and I'm going to change the zoom factor. When I say okay, and I dive in, you'll see that that zoom factor is now applied to every result that is in the test. So very, very easy to generate these results and set up these settings to retrieve the types of results that we want to see. We're going to talk about working with results in a further topic or a further entry in this video series here in a bit. So thank you all for attending, and hopefully you got some value out of this, and there will be a third entry soon. Thank you.